Good evening. Good to see everyone back out this evening. I hope and pray the Lord meets with us. We have a really good service, and when he meets, we do have a good service. Amen. Brother Greg Chapman, would you lead us in prayer, please? Amen. I think a lot of people have been praying lately. I think them services Sunday was a witness to that. I think we're starting to get serious about our relationship with the Lord. I was reading a little bit this morning. I love to read that Morning Evening by Charles Haddon Spurgeon. I like that. Anyway, the last part of it says, Revelation 3:14, the Amen. He is Amen as to the merit of his blood. He is Amen as to his righteousness. That sacred robe shall remain most fair and glorious when nature shall decay. He is Amen in every single title which he bears. Your husband, never seeking a divorce. Your friend, sticking closer than a brother. Your shepherd, with ye in death's dark vale. Your help and your deliverer. Your castle and your high tower. The horn of your strength. Your confidence. Your joy. Your all in all. And your yea and amen in all. He is yea and amen, just as he is, I am. Amen. If you would stand and get your All-American Church hymnal, turn to page number 79, At the Cross.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Sacred head for such a worm as I. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for crimes that myself away, 'tis all that
54, count your blessings. Let's do the first, second, the last verse. Page 54.
When upon life's billows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one, count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one, count your many blessings, see what God hath done. Are you ever burdened with the load of care? Does the cross seem heavy you are called to bear? Count your many blessings, every doubt will fly, and you will be singing as the days go by. Count your blessings, name them one by one, count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one, count your many blessings, see what God hath done. See amid the conflict, whether great or small, do not be discouraged, God is over all. Count your many blessings, angels will attend, help and comfort give you to your journey's end. Count your blessings, name them one by one, count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one, count your many blessings, see what God hath done.
Amen. Lord bless you.
Folks, today's the 19th. Caleb Wilson's going to sing for us.
Try and sing this song. I haven't sang it before. Sometimes the days are long and hard, and sometimes I don't feel like traveling on. Sometimes I'm pierced by Satan's darts, and sometimes I just want to go home. But always He is with me, and always He still cares, and always He reminds me that He will always be there. Sometimes I feel like I could die. Sometimes my world crumbles in my hands. Sometimes I'm weary from this old fight. And sometimes I'm just too weak to stand. But always He is with me, and always He still cares, and always He reminds me be there.
All right, thank you, brother. We'd like to mention that if you're not aware of it, Troy Smith passed on to be with the Lord, and he went to the hospital and didn't last long at all, so the good Lord took him. He didn't have to suffer a long time. Be having a funeral here Saturday, receiving friends from 10 till 12, and then we'll be having the funeral at 12 o'clock. And then Monday, I think it's still, is it still 3 o'clock in the afternoon? It'll be a private internment. So you all keep that in mind and pray for the family. I've known Troy ever since I've been here. He was here when I came here, and on 46 years, known him a long time. So I'll be preaching this coming Saturday. But since we'll be having the funeral here, the funeral home's gonna have to be able to get into this building and bring the flowers and setting the stuff up. And I wonder if there's anybody in here tonight that has a key or has access to this building that could come that morning and open this thing up and have it open for them. Thank you, brother. I appreciate that. I don't know what time they plan to be here, but you could check with them. I think it's Lynnhurst, isn't it, down here on Adair? Is that who has it, Michelle? So you check with them, see what time they need to be here so you can open the building. So please pray for them. I've known his family, all of the family down through the years, a long time. And so Troy now has gone on. So y'all pray for them. Does anybody else have a prayer request tonight while we're doing this? Yes, sir?
I don't know if you and church still remember the Charles Stanley family, he passed away.
Yes. Yeah, I saw that. He was 90 years old. 90. Yeah, I don't know. Apparently that was sudden, because I hadn't heard anything about him being sick or anything. But anyway, that's just as well. I mean, when God gets ready for you and takes you, that's all right. So please pray for his family. Amen. Brother Stanley. Does anybody else have requests tonight? Yes, ma'am.
I remember Matthew. He was here on Easter Sunday, and he seems to really enjoy it. And he's been visiting us a lot lately.
Good.
Just really praying that he'll come back, and the Lord will just continue to work in his heart.
Amen.
Thank you for all the prayers.
Yes. Good. Good. Yes. It'll take spiritual power to do what needs to be done. Amen. All right. Anybody else? Little hand right there. Yes. All right. Your mom has stomach pains. Well, let's pray for her then. All right. I didn't catch that part now. Okay. All right. Yes, sir.
Along with her, pray for, continue to pray for John Harkin's brother as he's recovering. And then David and Carissa Britton, they came here for some time with David's mother-in-law and Carissa's mom. Sat back here, a young couple, got beautiful kids. His mom is on her deathbed right now. So pray for that family.
All right, amen. Okay, anybody else? Yes, sir.
I didn't know if I was going to work security or not, but anyway, Howard Miller, Janie fell on her head. She's in the hospital. ICU. And I have a friend whose name's Joe Lowry. His wife has AFib, and he's real concerned about her. He listens religiously.
Yes, sir. All right. Okay, anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
Pray for my brother-in-law. He just recently had a first cousin that killed himself. And then within the same couple of days, his uncle just passed away. And he's got another uncle
All right. Okay. Yes, ma'am. All right. Anybody else? Yes, sir. Yeah, that's sad. All right, anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
My youngest grandson was only 5 weeks old with RSV.
He's got RSV? Okay. And he's 5 weeks old, you say? I just remember him in prayer. All right, anybody else? Yes, sir. Okay. All right. Yes, ma'am.
Keep praying for Bailey. She came back up here yesterday. She's been down there for a week. She got a job and another job. So just keep praying for her. They keep messing with her mind, trying to get her to come back down there, and it's just a struggle for her, really. And she's so easily influenced by them. So just keep praying for her.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Yes. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Yeah. Spiritually, this country's on life support. Oh, yeah. All right, anybody else? Yes, ma'am. Anybody else? We have unspoken requests tonight? Brother David Valance, lead us in prayer, would you please?
Our dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we're so thankful that we can still come here and worship you, Lord, and open up the Word and hear what you have to tell us. Lord, we're so thankful we have a pastor that stands on the Word of God. We're so thankful that we have a church family that wants to hear and wants to learn and wants to know the truth. Lord, I pray for this lady that's in the nursing home that's 99 years old, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you'll go to this lady and open up the Word of God to her and show her need for salvation. Because the dying to go to hell is the worst thing that I can think of anyone doing. Lord, I pray for this lady. I pray that you'll open up her heart. And Lord, I pray for Brother Caleb's father and family. I pray that you'll open up their hearts. I pray especially for a brother that's lost. He needs to be healed. I pray for you're in control and that you'll heal this. Pray for Jane Miller. I pray, Lord, that you'll help her, and I pray that you'll take care of this problem with her injury. I pray for this friend, the Lowry's, Lord. I pray that you'll heal his wife of this AFib, Lord. Lord, I pray, and I give praise to you, Lord, today for Matt Wright and what you've done with him and what you're doing with him. And I pray, Lord, that you'll continue to open up his heart to the truth. And, Lord, I pray for these people that I deal with all week long, Lord. They're so self-centered, Lord. And it's not about us, Lord. It's about you. And everything has to be centered around you for us to have any kind of idea of what's really going on. You're our Savior. You're everything. You're our Creator. And Lord, if we just keep our minds on you, Lord, we don't have to worry about what's going on in this world. Lord, we love you and we thank you, Lord. We praise your name, and we pray, even so, come, Lord Jesus. Come as soon as you can, Lord. Because I know I'm waiting for you. And I know everyone here is waiting. And I pray for this Toombs family, Lord, that you'll help that young girl. And I pray that you'll help the whole family. Just bless them and bring them closer to me. And I pray that for all of us, Lord. Just draw us closer to you in these last and final minutes that we're living in. Blessed be your holy name, Christ in Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior.
Amen. Amen. If you have your Bible, turn to the Gospel of John, chapter 1. The Gospel of John, chapter number 1. Now, you know I've laid down a foundation to you many, many times. The things that I teach about these so-called synoptic Gospels and then the Gospel of John, I was never taught that through all the years of coming up, until God finally began to teach me and open my soul to understand. Once I did, I began to understand a lot of things about the Bible, not everything. But in due time, he may show me more. And we ought to all pray for that tonight. In due time, show us more. Amen. If you lack wisdom, ask of God, who upbraideth not and giveth to all men liberally. Verse 1, John chapter number 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word. The Word here is Logos. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All right, so there we establish something. The Apostle John says that the Word was God. Look at verse 14. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Now, who is that? So he's the Word, and he's what then? He's God. The Apostle tells you right off the bat, no question about it, he's God. And notice carefully how that we go from eternal, the Word, verse number 1, in the beginning was the Word, in from eternal into temporal, because in verse number 14, he was made flesh. We no longer know him after the flesh, but he was here for a determined period of time. Look at verse 2. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. And the apostle says in Colossians essentially the same thing. They were made by him and for him. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. Now we have a life here. This is unlike any other life. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. Notice how that life and light are connected. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Therefore, though present, the inability of the creature to comprehend this light. We're talking about a supernatural light. The Bible says in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, and he said, let there be light. All right, the light that was allowed to come into existence or to show forth was not the sun and the moon. It's an entirely different light, and that's the light you're looking at here. This is important because the Apostle John lays great emphasis upon the light. Now, you understand what light is good for. We turn the light out in here, it gets dark. You need light. There are a lot of different reasons, but we're not going to deal with that tonight. The Bible says in verse number 6, was a man sent from God whose name was John. This is John the Baptizer, or John the Baptist. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. Now watch this. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. Note carefully now. Notice how that we go from small case, verse number 5, L-I-G-H-T, to large case, verse number 7, capital L-I-G-H-T. Obviously, the printer wants you to know there's a difference going on here. He was not that light. But now, verse number 9, and we'll stop reading here. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. Lord, bless this book now, thy holy name. Amen. Now, when you go to John chapter number 15, he said, I am the true vine. He says true because it is set in contradistinction to a false vine. And here in chapter 1, to a false light. It's important to understand, therefore, that when God starts talking about light, it is something that he holds us accountable for. Light is a big deal with the Almighty. Now, the Gospel of John, chapter number 10, if you'd like to turn there, in verse number 27. Let's read that tonight. John, chapter number 10, and verse number 27. Now, of course, when I said to you this a little while ago about the synoptic gospel, do you remember me using that term? Here and there I use that term, okay, but I don't subscribe to it. I just use it because I know it exists, and some people use it for reference. I don't believe it. I believe every single gospel is in there for a reason, to give you a specific viewpoint that the Holy Spirit wants you to have. And when you try to create harmonies of the gospel, that's okay, that's fine, well and good. But you want to know the truth about it, and I'll save you an awful lot of research. Nobody can harmonize Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Completely. Can't do it. But it's not written to be harmonized. It's written to give you an account that the apostle wanted you to have. And now look at verse number, John 10, verse number 27. And in verse number 27, he said, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them temporal life. As long as they hold out and work hard for it, meanwhile, good intentions, they'll be okay. Is that right? That's way off the mark, right? Let's see what it says. I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. There's nothing conditional about this. This is an absolute statement. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father, which gave them me, no man can come to me except the Father which hath sent me draw him. My Father, which gave them to me, is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. Now, what is that, preacher? That is eternal security. That's what it is. That's what it is. Now, we have been erroneously accused and will continue to be erroneously accused of teaching that a man can be saved and live any way he wants to, and when he dies, he'll go to heaven. That his eternal security, you know, that we preach, we teach, is simply a license to sin. Okay? Now, here's the problem. You can study the Bible, read the Bible, and skim across the surface and get your list from your denomination of what you're supposed to believe, and I'll guarantee you 99 out of 100, that's how they'll believe. Whatever their denominational creed happens to be, that's what they'll believe. And they won't go any further than that. Nothing would make me happier tonight than for you, whether you agree or disagree with anything that I teach, if you will do your own research. Amen. Read it for yourself. That would give me great joy, is to know that you care enough to know why you believe what you believe. You may agree with Pastor Lawson, you may not agree with Pastor Lawson. That's fine with me, because believe me, all the men, and I have a great number of men that I have the greatest respect for, I sit in their class and listen to them teach. I'll find myself agreeing probably 90 to 95% of the time, but there will be times that I do not agree with what they say. So what do you do? Get mad, throw your rattler out on the floor, kick slabs out of your crib, and stop taking your formula and walk out the back door. Have you ever seen anybody do that? What about them do it right here? Just get up and stomp off. No, you have to have the grace of God. I like the idea that you can think for yourself. And here's the truth. This is the truth. If what you believe is based on the foundation of the Scripture, what are you afraid of? What are you afraid of? If someone doesn't agree with you, if what you believe is supported by what you understand the Bible to mean and say, then what's the problem? See, I can respect someone who does not agree with me. I have no respect for someone who gets mad at me and tries to ram down my throat what he or she believes with the idea that if you don't believe me, we can't have fellowship one with another. See, that idea. No, I don't accept that whatsoever. So what's all that for then? Well, it's for this. This is as clear a statement as you can get to eternal security. You say, well, now there are passages in the Bible that talk about how you can lose your salvation or you can fall away and this and that and this and that. We'll deal with some of that tonight. But first of all, let's get the foundation laid. What gospel are you reading? You're reading John. John is the only gospel that says you must be born again. Matthew, Mark, and Luke doesn't say a word about it. This does not mean that they're bad. You know, you understand, they each has its place, like I said a moment ago. Matthew, the gospel of the kingdom. Mark, the gospel of the servant. Luke, the gospel of the man. A genealogy that carries Mary all the way back to God. And Adam was the son of God. We have a perfect lineage genealogy of pure human beings. And I'm not up here preaching a Satan seed doctrine. But I take what it says and accept it for what it says. Whatever else may apply to this, deal with that later. But that's a fact. Mary was a pure human being. And she was a virgin daughter of Zion. And she brought into this world the seed that the Apostle Paul gets into over there in the book of Galatians. The word seed in Hebrew is zerah. And we find it in Genesis 3:15, and the seed of the woman. And the translation of that could be the children of the woman, the one seed of the woman, or whatever else you might want to interpret it to mean. So what do you do? How do you interpret that? You let the Bible interpret it. When you get to the book of Galatians, the Apostle Paul tells you plainly that the seed that was in the woman was the seed of Abraham. And it was the seed of Abraham by faith and promise, that it didn't come from a man, it came from God. And that seed was Christ. Now he makes it plain. He makes it plain. So, you know, you can play with words in Hebrew all you want to. But the bottom line is the Bible has interpreted itself. We don't have time to get into all that tonight, but read it for yourself when you get home. And it's a great blessing to let the Bible interpret the Bible. Because when a word can be translated 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 different ways, then let the Bible tell you which way to translate it. That's what I'm saying tonight. And that's what's wrong with that? A lexicon is a good thing to have, and a lexicon is dangerous for somebody that had just a little bit of understanding. And they get into word games and, you know, and all of a sudden they're masters of theology and all that. You let the Bible interpret the Bible.
Amen. In this passage here, verse 26, summarize what you're saying.
Yeah, not of his sheep. Yeah, yes, sir, brother. His sheep, he says, he also says that I have other sheep that are not of this flock. And who are these other sheep? Well, we're going to talk about that tonight. I'll get 1 John chapter 5 and verse number 13. Now, 1 John 5:13. And who wrote 1 John? The same man that wrote the gospel, right? Yes. Yes. Now, look at verse 13. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that you have what? Eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. Same John, same doctrine, nothing's changed. He believed in eternal security in the gospel and in what we call epistles, letters, what that simply means. 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. Now, why is the gospel of John, therefore, the one that we go to to establish the doctrine of eternal security. Why don't we go to Matthew? Why don't we go to Mark? Why don't we go to Luke? What makes the difference? Well, like I said, John chapter number 3, Nicodemus, ye must be born again. Right? Why does Matthew, Mark, and Luke not say that? Because that's not the burden of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. The burden of Matthew, Mark, and Luke has to do with genealogies, and it has to do with the kingdoms. And these kingdoms and genealogies are the burden, and they have their place dispensationally. They have their place in the Bible, and in time, they have their place. And when you try to ram John into Matthew, you get in trouble. This is why the last gospel written was the Gospel of John. And this is why the Gospel of John, and some people are so bad against it, they throw it out and say it's not even inspired scripture. But there's no doubt in my mind that it's inspired. None whatsoever. The Apostle Peter also preaches the new birth. In 1 Peter, he talks about the new birth, and this is good that he does, because it tells you, and so does Paul. So does the Apostle Paul. But the Apostle Peter, when he deals with the new birth, he says, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. Yes, yes, amen. Being born again. Now, when we look at the light, here's what it says in the Gospel of John about the light. Verse number one, chapter one. John 1. And verse number 9. That was the true light, capital L-I-G-H-T, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. Okay, now what you have here, when it's capitalized like this, you have personification. This is a word light, but it has to do with person. See, he was the true Christ. He was the true Jesus. He was the true Savior that cometh into the world. But notice carefully what it says. He lighteth every man that cometh into the world. Now, here we go. When you get into that, you have to look at that and you think, well, now let's run to the Greek scholars and see if this translation is correct. And that's what a lot of them do. And here's what some of them say. Coming into the world, he was the light that lighteth every man. Plain words, when he appeared physically in the world during his lifetime, he was the light of the world, and he certainly was, but they limit the understanding and translation of it to that period of time. Now, is there a light in this world tonight? The entrance of thy word giveth what? All right, this is light, and it shines on darkness, shines on sin, number thing. Is the Lord Jesus Christ still the light of the world? Of course he is. He is. He'll always will be. He is the light that lights the way into the presence of an invisible being that cannot be known, that cannot be approached, that cannot be understood any other way except by the Lord Jesus Christ. And the occult world is working hard tonight to try to define to you what God is like. And their concept of God is entirely separate from the Word of God. So we start out, he's the light that lighteth every man that cometh into the world. Now that you're faced with a problem when you read something like this. How do you interpret that? I mean, the interpretation, not interpretation, translation is correct. No doubt in my mind. This is translated from the majority text. There's nothing wrong with this translation, but how do we understand that? This is the key to studying the Bible. This is the key to understanding the Scripture, right? All right, let's say this. Let's say that in your soul, when you came into existence, you came into this world, God put a light in there that would eventually shine brighter and brighter and brighter, that by more and more you would give an account for, that was in you, but it would also judge your motives from the moment you come into this world and the moment you're old enough to comprehend what's going on. That light, because the light shines on the soul, it opens you up. All right, that's what it does. It opens you up, that light does. Now, I want you to turn to the book of Romans, and I'm just giving you these tonight to make you study. We're not going to come to a conclusion on it. But I want you to know what's in here. All right, Romans chapter number 2. I was reading today about some of the rich preachers in the country. One of them has a mansion that's worth about $30 million. I thought to myself, good night. I'd have to hire a staff to keep it clean. That's an awful big house. $30 million. They say the Lord Jesus was rich, was he? What did he tell them? He said, the foxes have their holes, but the Son of Man hath not a place to lay his head. When he had to pay his taxes, did he write a check for it and go to his bank and withdraw the money? No. Fish brought it for him, right? Yes, he did. Okay, now, but now here's the thing, Linda, folks. You too, Linda. Here's the thing. You live in a country, and you live in a $30 million house, and you drive a Bentley, and you drive a Rolls Royce, and you're a prosperity pimp, and that's what they are, and you're preaching this stuff to people. What have you done with the light that was in your soul? See, think about that. What have you done with it? Now look at Romans chapter number 2 and verse number 6. Romans 2:6. Who will render to every man according to his deeds? God's a just God and no respecter of persons. Do you believe that? Yes, sir. I don't care who you are, where you were born. He makes no difference. To them who by patient continuance in well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, eternal life. But unto them that are contentious and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation and wrath, tribulation and anguish upon every soul of man that doeth evil, of the Jew first and also to the Greek. Verse 11. At verse 10, but glory, honor, and peace to every man that worketh good, to the Jew first, also to the Gentile, for there is no respect of persons with God. For as many as have sinned without law shall also perish without law. And as many as have sinned in the law shall be judged by the law. For not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified. For when the Gentiles, which have not the law, do by nature the things contained in the law, these having not the law are a law unto themselves, which show the work of the law written in their hearts, their conscience also bearing witness, and their thoughts the meanwhile accusing or else excusing one another, in the day when God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ according to my gospel. So what does that mean, preacher? Pray over it. Ask God for wisdom. See if you come up with a conviction from it. There are many things that go through my mind tonight. Right now, I'm thinking about them. Many things that I think about all day long, every day of my life. There are many things that I meditate on. I pray, ask God for wisdom in these things. When I see the jaded, hypocritical, materialistic thing that calls itself the Church of God in this country, that possessions, pornography, and everything else that runs rampant inside the church house, when I see that, I say to myself, there's got to be something better than this. There's got to be more than this. And of course, it's the Bible. Amen. God knows. He's a sovereign being. He knew before it ever happened that it would happen. He never reacts to anything. Never. Never. He never reacts to anything. Known unto God are all of his works. So, God gives me a light. I don't want the light. God says, all right, you don't have to have the light. I reject the light. All right, you've rejected the light. The light's gone. Now walk in darkness. But where's darkness going to take you? Darkness will lead you to damnation. It'll lead you to damnation. There's no hope. Why does it do that? Because you're blind. You're stumbling in darkness. And without the light, there's no way in the world you'd ever find God. You can't find him. I want you to look at something now in chapter number 1 of Romans. I want you to look at something here. Romans 1. Okay. And I want you to notice the progression, because it's here. In Romans chapter number 1, verse number, verse 25. Who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause, now look at this, God gave them up unto vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. Is there anyone in the house tonight that does not understand what that means? I'm sure all of you do. Okay? All right. Likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was meet. Obviously, 2,000 years ago when the apostle wrote to the Romans, they had physical problems. They had physical problems. They might have even had an AIDS epidemic. Who knows? Verse 28, and even, now watch this, even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. Now look what happens with a reprobate mind. Being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful. Now look at verse number 32. This is the progression. Who, knowing the judgment of God, all right, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. Okay? I'm not the judge. You're not the judge. God's the judge. Have you noticed the commercials now on television? In one day's time, how many men do you see holding the hand of men? And you see that? And women with women. You see that? Obviously, it's all day long. It's all day long. You say one thing they don't like, and they are offended. And if they can possibly do it, they'll make it hate speech. But they can turn around and they can ram down your throat everything the apostle mentions in Romans chapter number 1. Here's my question tonight for you or anyone else. How long will this go? And what's this going to lead to? And there was something else too that has proved to me what I've thought for a long time. There is a clearinghouse in this country somewhere for commercials. What do you mean by that? There is a standard of what has to be in a commercial, and it has to pass that standard. And I don't care if you're selling cars or you're selling insurance or whatever you're doing, you have to present it to that clearinghouse, and they will determine whether it is woke enough, politically correct enough, and whatever, and then they'll send it back to you and say, this is okay, you can use it. You know why I say that? Because, have you noticed? In the last year, they've all gone this way fast. Have you noticed? Have you noticed? Yes, they have. And there's a consistency in it. You watch them. I don't care what they're selling. It makes a difference. There's a consistency. You're going to get the same thing over and 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 over again all day long. You're going to get it. And what they're doing is not only knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, they do it and take pleasure in them that do it also. So we're living in the end of the end. You're living in a country that's on its deathbed spiritually. And if the Almighty does not come into this country and bring a real revival, I mean a real one, and how many would like to see a real revival? Wouldn't it be something? I'm not talking about a bunch of people wallowing around on the floor, barking like dogs, and, you know, crazy, crazy stuff. I'm talking about when people come under conviction of sin and the Lord Jesus Christ is exalted, and men and women and young people start getting saved, and power comes back to the church, and it comes back to the church to such a degree that it has the effect of salt and light on the culture. Right now, the church has no salt and no light on the culture. None. Anything goes. And this is where we are. It's because this country has rejected the light it had, and it's been turned to darkness. And when it's turned to darkness, then it goes off into this perversion. I read one today, last night I was on YouTube, and I watched this person. She said, I am neither feminine gender or masculine gender, or what's that other term? Binary. She said, I'm none of them. I'm somewhere in between. I said, it's okay. That's what she is. But here's the thing. Have you noticed the progression now? You're talking about the trans movement, you know, changing from boys to girls and girls to boys. And here's the thing, too. If you live long enough, the Lord doesn't come back and get his church, mark it down, there's going to be a lot of boys in this country that are going to be very, very, very angry when they hit their adult years and realize that their body has been mutilated and they can no longer be a man. You mark it down. That day's coming. That day's going to come. But here we are. You see, right before your very eyes, all of this is changing at warp speed. At warp speed. And now we have introduced to us another element that wasn't even here just a few years ago. That's artificial intelligence. And would you pray for me? Because I've been spending some time digging into artificial intelligence. I have to educate myself as to what's happening with this. All of the ramifications of it, how it's going to affect. It is a big deal. When one of the smartest, richest men in the country, and his name's Elon Musk, he's from South Africa, smart and rich. He says this about artificial intelligence. He says it can be very dangerous. Very dangerous. To the point, and I know this, and I'm sure many of you know this now, artificial intelligence is so smart that it can communicate, create their own language. And these I don't know, I'm not going to use the word sentient yet, but these beings can machines can communicate with each other in a language that they have created if they're that smart. And they come to a point to where they are literally able to take over. Do you think they'd let you know? Uh-uh. No. It would make Pearl Harbor look like a picnic. And God forbid, brave men died at Pearl Harbor, December the 7th, 1941. Don't ever forget those young men and women that died at Pearl Harbor. Thousands of them died down there. So what am I saying? I'm saying tonight, as these men are warning and saying there should be a 6-month moratorium where artificial intelligence is stopped, capped. Let's not let it get any further, because there's something going on that we don't even understand, and we're the creators of it. There's an intelligence going on here that moves at warp speed. And it may very well have already tapped in to what it needs to control you and control mankind. Remember this, you get tired from studying, it never does. Your mind can only think so fast. These things think at warp speed. Artificial intelligence is something that has just come upon you. And mark it down. Anything that happens like that, it happens when God says for it to happen. It happens why God says for it to happen. And it'll happen exactly the way God allows it to happen. And it'll bring glory to God. We may be on the cusp of hearing the shout and leave out of here. That excites me. It excites me, not because this nation may go to war against this nation. It's been that way for 2,000 years. And that's not to belittle what the Lord said about nation against nation. But what gets me is this new stuff that we've never heard of. Never heard of it. Tonight, how many of you have heard of artificial intelligence, but it's just simply a cursory thing? You just heard about it and that's it. No more. Well, that's what I'm doing now. I'm researching it. I've got into the books and got into the research. And one of the most important things to do when you research is get you a good researcher. find somebody who knows what he's doing, knows what he's talking about. Well, how do you know he knows what he's talking about when you don't know anything about it? See, that's a good question. That's where you need to do some heavy-duty praying. And ask God to give you wisdom. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Daniel said, knowledge shall increase. Yeah, it'll increase. Well, it's there, folks. It's there. It's there. And the church is not going to stop it. Okay, well, I'll stop with this now tonight. Losing salvation, the Bible, has to do with people at a period of time. Okay? The early apostasy back at the temple, when the church first started, you had Jews going back into Judaism. You had Judaizers that were trying to drag the law into grace. You had all this going on. Well, in 1 John chapter number 2 and verse number 19, the Apostle John says they went out from us because they were not of us. And they went out from us that it might be made known that they were not of us. So he left. You have tribulation saints in Matthew chapter number 24 that must endure to the end in order to be saved. Don't ever let anybody drag you into the 24th chapter of the book of Matthew to try to prove to you can lose your salvation. There's not a single Christian in the bunch. There's no church there. Amen. Church is not there. Amen. There's a fellow on the internet saying, Christians can go to hell. No, they cannot go to hell. A Christian is a born-again believer, and there is no way, born of the Spirit of God, you'll ever go to hell. Can't do it. You can't do it. Third one is in Acts chapter 8 and verse number 13, profession or no possession. You remember what I'm talking about? Simon the sorcerer. You remember him? He believed also. You remember what he asked? When he saw by laying on of hands the Holy Ghost was given by the apostles, he said, ah, let me buy that. Boy, would I not build my business. Let me buy that. And the apostle rebuked him and said, your heart's not right with God. You have no part with what's going on. Well, this is what's going on in the church today. And this is the prosperity pimps, the ones out there. Yes, they are. They are. And then the church age is the age of the new birth. Have you been born again? If you've been born again, let me give you a simple test to let you know if you've been born again. It's simple. So how do you know it, preacher? You love the Lord Jesus Christ. You love him. You love him. You think about him all day long. When you hear somebody preaching about him, you say, glory to God, if they're exalting Christ and not exalting themselves. You love him. You love the Lord Jesus. You want his name preached. I must decrease, he must increase. There's just something about him that draws the Christian. It pulls something out of you. It's him. It's about him, folks. That's when the Holy Ghost moves in. The Bible said in John 16, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will not speak of himself, but he will glorify me. That's what the Holy Ghost does. If you have the Holy Spirit of God tonight, you're born again, he'll glorify Christ. If you think that you can be born again and not have the Holy Spirit, you need to go back to the Bible because somebody messed you up big time. You do not need to seek the Holy Spirit once you're born again. The Bible said, for by one Spirit are we all baptized in the one body. There is no way you can be a born-again believer tonight and not have the Holy Ghost. That's an impossibility. Amen. Father, bless your word and time we have together. Open our hearts to understand a simple truth. In Galatians, you tell us about the fruit, the Spirit, and all these wonderful things. And our Father, we know that the Holy Spirit will bring these into our lives. And we know that we are not what we used to be. We know that there's somebody living in us that wasn't in there before. We can't fully explain it to somebody else. And we certainly can't have them feel what we feel. But Lord, we know whom we have believed. And we're persuaded he's able to keep that which we've committed to him against that day. We know we've passed from death unto life. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, folks. We meet again, Lord willing, Sunday. And don't forget the funeral this coming Saturday. They receive friends from 10 to 12 here at Temple. And then we have a funeral at 12. So I'm sure the family, if you can't make it, please pray for them. Well, if you can come and support them, that'd be good, too. Let's stand up now. We'll have prayer and we'll let you go. Brother Ronnie Crane, will you dismiss?
Father, we thank you, Lord, for the precious word of God. And we pray tonight, Lord. Lord, and we never give you enough praise, Lord. We just bless your name tonight. God, we lift our hands to you tonight, Father God, and just thank you, Lord. God, we serve a holy and a righteous God.